Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions, putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Permanence Principles presentation, Jesus briefly summarizes God's principles of permanence that govern the operation of God's laws, gives examples of the way these principles are built into God's laws, and answers audience questions about the principles. Recorded on the 6th of November 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Well, today, so yesterday was a day where we were basically going over six of the fundamental principles, which we joined together because they really are paired together in a lot of ways. And that meant that we covered six in, you know, in 20 minutes each, sort of. That's all we had time for. Today, from now on, it's a bit different because we're going to now spend about 40 minutes each on each principle from now on. So all of the principles for the rest of the group are going to be 40-minute presentations pretty much, except for the few in the final session, which will be longer again because we feel they're more important and we need to explain them more in more detail. So here we are today, second day, morning, and want to look at this principle, the permanence principles, and what that's all about. And some of you got some good questions there, a bit of confusion about that compared to the development principles as well, because obviously the development principles enforce change on creation and the permanence principles say that the laws are all consistent. So how does that happen? So we need to have a look at that as well. Yeah. Good, so let's get started, shall we? All right. So permanence principles mean that all creation can rely on permanent law. And by the way, the principles are also permanent, as well as the laws being permanent. They can rely on permanent law by ensuring that each law is, or all laws are, unchangeable, consistent, permanent, and self-enforcing. And one of the things we're going to look at a bit later is the permanence comparison, if you like, between what we expect as humans from law and what God does with law. And you'll see that we have huge amounts of problem in this area of permanence. And this is one of the reasons why we're actually spending a bit more time on the issue. Permanence demonstrates God's love for humanity, but also demonstrates God's the importance that God places upon truth as well. So permanence principles are very important principles to understand in your life. And they're very important if you're going to ever embrace change, because the permanence principles help you see the consistency of law and therefore allow you to measure the results of each law. And this is very, very important for your progression. If everything was unpredictable, then basically you'd just be guessing what it might be or what it might not be. But permanence allows everything to be no longer guessed, but actually to be an actual fact, and with regard to everything that happens to you, but also everything that happens around you. So this is very, very good. It's structured, verifiable, and mathematical. So every law is very organized, has a lot of order. In fact, you'll see in the order principles how much order there is with regard to principles generally, but the permanence principles allow for order to exist, and they allow for verifiable mathematical formulae to be created to describe the law. And this is a very important thing if we wish to create devices or we wish to make progress. And we need to know what the laws are so we can make calculations, mathematical calculations and assumptions, which we then place into the different creations that we might have. Does that make sense? So this is a very important part of law. They're measurable, quantifiable, and observable. So you can get to a result through what you would call empirical evidence or evidence that you get through your own life, but you can also get through a result through some kind of measuring system. So every single thing is measurable. Now, of course, the more higher the creation, the more difficult it is to create a measuring device to measure it. Right? And of course, that means that the very highest creation and the emotions that flow through the soul of the highest creation are going to be quite difficult to measure using material measuring devices. So obviously we need to create new types of devices to measure, but at the end of the day, everything is measurable and quantifiable, which is great if you want to discover things and experiment with things. So in the spirit world, there is a very large amount of people who were scientists on Earth who continue to be scientists in the spirit world. They continue doing experiments. They make devices that measure things in the spirit world just like they would here on Earth. But the devices obviously are made from different types of materials and so forth, based on their advanced education that they've received in the higher universities of life, I suppose you could call it. When it gets to the soul side of things, though, we stop generally creating devices to measure things because the soul is actually a measuring instrument in itself. And the way God created the human soul is that it can measure things quite easily. So this means then once you connect with that ability, you're able to personally measure things very, very accurately. And whether that be time, distance, space, anything you want to measure can be accurately measured just using your soul. And you could sort of liken it to a person who goes around on Earth here. Sometimes you see people who have, usually they've been a bit spirit over cloak, but you sometimes see people who, you know, they can tell you a distance of something down to a millimetre. Now the spirit who's telling them the distance doesn't measure it with a tape measure or something. So how do they measure that distance? They obviously have methods of measuring it that actually are very accurate that allow for those kind of measurements to take place. So this is what abilities you'll develop over time. And when you connect to your soul, these abilities develop much more rapidly. So you can actually tell how long things are, not from, or how wide things are, or how high things are, or what is going on with specific things internally, without even having to open them up to check them out. So that'd be handy for a doctor operating on you, if you think about it, if he could change some things energetically rather than actually changing some things in the body itself. So you could say that medicine nowadays is still very rudimentary compared to what we could possibly do on Earth. And the reason why that is because medicine really has only been developed in the last last few hundred years, the Western medicine. Of course, there are other medicines that have been developed for much longer, but there's still a lot of problems with both of them. One of them is heavily spirit-influenced, the ones that have been developed longer, and the ones that have been developed now with scientific evidence is a very limited scientific evidence to develop the medicine. And so, unfortunately, it means that the medicine itself is quite limited. But those things can also all be corrected because of this principle, really. Everything is measurable, quantifiable. That makes everything safe and predictable. And I smile at you about that because most of you don't feel your life safe at all. And I'm saying to you, well, no, God's actually made everything safe. And for the majority of you, your fear about things is unfounded. And if you think about it, most of your fear is not related to what God has created, but rather is related to what humans might do with what God created. So and this is why our fear has been created generally is because humans have turned some things around and made everything unpredictable. And humans do things sometimes one way and sometimes the other, and it's hard for you to predict what that might be. Of course, if you're connected to your soul, you can predict it. But if you're not connected to your soul and you're just observing their behaviour, you think it's very unpredictable. But once you can measure what's going on in the soul, you can predict pretty much every action and interaction. So for myself and Mary now in our life, it's pretty difficult for something to surprise us. Does that make sense? Because most of what we see going around us is predictable based on what we can measure from people's emotional condition and their desires and their true nature and what's really going on in their personality. And so you can measure a lot of things like that. And so some things do surprise us, but not a lot. And even things that happen to us where we get a sickness or an illness of some kind, which occasionally happens still, That doesn't surprise us either, because we know the emotion that we're holding on to, that we're suppressing in that moment. And so we know that sooner or later we're probably going to get that particular problem occur as a result of that particular issue that we have, that we haven't yet dealt with. Does that make sense? So everything is pretty predictable in that regard.
Yep.
Of course, a person's will and desire is less predictable. Particularly their desire is what makes a person less predictable. Your addictions make you very predictable, but addictions are not the same as desires, which we'll learn about in the last session. So there's the permanence principles. Let's have a look at some examples. If we go back to our gravity example. Well, it's pretty easy to see that it's consistent. It's a consistent law. You don't walk out one day and gravity is no longer 9.8 metres per second squared, but it's now 2.3 metres per second squared. And when you take a step, instead of taking a step that just takes 1 metre or so, you take a step and all of a sudden you're over at the end of the wall or something like that. It's very predictable, you see. Every time you take a step, you know it's probably going to be about the same amount. And if you run, you know it's probably going to be the same amount of pacing that you do, and the stride is going to be about the same. And you know that if you jump over something, that it's not going to fly up and catch you while you're jumping over it, unless you do something that's out of harmony with your own connection with the gravity itself. But imagine if gravity was actually unpredictable every moment. How unsafe would you then feel? So at one moment you're walking along, next moment you're hitting your head on the roof because you've been bouncing a bit and up on the roof, so you knock yourself out, and the next moment you get up, you walk along again and you take a stride and you're at the end of the door and you smash your face in the door. It would be so unpredictable that your whole personal safety, even your physical body, would not be able to sustain life if it's that unpredictable. Right, so that's why God's made these things predictable. The law constant based upon a whole number of factors, which we'll go into when we look at how the laws are actually created in scope. If we look at aerodynamics, the higher law, once known and understood, can be reliably, consistently, mathematically, safely and securely engaged. If it wasn't like that, I doubt whether any of you would have chosen to fly. Right? To come here, for example, because it would be so unpredictable, your very life would be at stake at every moment throughout the flight. Even throughout the flight, it's a good day today, we can fly. It would be, is it a good moment for flying right now or not? And any moment might change that, which would be, yeah, as you can imagine, would be disastrous. And also, you can also see that it would be very difficult for you to actually learn about flight. If one day there's a whole different principles involved in flight and the next day there's a whole new group of principles that are involved in flight that you have to recalculate everything for, it'd be also very difficult to create a device that permanently engages flight. So, because one day you'd have to make it with wings twice as long and twice as wide and bigger curvature and a larger thrust, and the next day you might be able to just make a little tiny thing you sit in and it would still go, you know what I mean? Just depending on the different laws that were involved, each day changing would create this unpredictability. So you imagine if you're a scientist, it would be very frustrating trying to do something or get something done when everything is so unpredictable. I'm going to skip Fibonacci because I want to talk about Fibonacci in a bit of detail at the end of the examples. Let's look at cause and effect. Every effect has the same cause. That applies to the human body, applies to the human soul, applies to the human spirit body, applies to every creature around us, applies to why an insect bites you, why... You know, anything might happen in the why you have an accident. Everything of a certain kind has a certain cause. If it's the same cause or the same effect, it had the same cause, always. So, you know, if you get cancer in your left breast, then it has a cause that's specific, and it's the same cause whether you're a man, woman, child, doesn't matter, and it's the same cause whether you live on the opposite side of the world, and it's the same cause no matter what is going on in your life. Cancer in the left breast means the same problem. Right? And if you can find the cause, the effect is the same, so the cause has got to be the same. Once you find the cause, you can cure it, obviously, if you knew what the cause was. Make sense? Same applies to any accident you have. Somebody breaks their leg. If it's their left leg and the bottom section of the leg and happens to be the first, what's the first one called? Not the shin bone, is it, or whatever, but it's not its technical name. I don't know its technical name. Tibia, whatever it is. And so that one breaks, and it breaks in a certain location, it's always the same problem. Every time. Now, this is an undiscovered area of medicine. Nobody has done any correlative information about any of this, and so humankind don't believe that is true. But the reality is, if you could correlate the data, you would actually come up with exactly the same emotional causes in each situation. This is a good area for somebody who's a scientist to have a look at it, isn't it? Let's look at the human soul. Changes in my soul are measurable and repeatable. So I know that if I cure a certain problem in my soul, it will have a subsequent effect on my spirit body and a subsequent effect on my physical body, and that is also measurable. I can measure it by examining, well, through empirical evidence, by examining my physical body and spirit body, but I can actually also feel the change that occurs in my soul if I'm sensitive enough, and I'll know that that particular thing now is going to result in this particular thing being fixed. Now that I've dealt with that problem, this will be fixed. Does that make sense? You also know if you're not dealing with the problem that it's not going to get fixed. You also know that, like, at the moment I'm holding on to a lot of fear, for example, still about violence and stuff like that. We get a fair bit of it, so, you know, naturally, and we've had a fair bit of it in the past, myself and Mary and any of the 14 actually who have returned have the same problem. And so they're going to have problems in a certain area of their body until that emotion is released. And that's the way it goes. Because the law applies to them just as much as it applies to you. Because it's permanent. It's unchangeable. The law applies, doesn't matter who you are. Does that make sense? So when you think about it, permanence also creates fairness. Doesn't it? And the big complaint that we have in our childhoods generally is that mum and dad were pretty unfair. They might have had a favourite and they let the favourite get away with a whole heap of things, and the other person, you or the other person, wasn't allowed to get away with that particular thing that the favourite was allowed to get away with. Right? Creates a lot of feelings of unfairness. Well, with God, everything's fair. If you've got the same problem as somebody else, then it means it's the same cause. There's no difference between those two things. And it doesn't matter who you are, how developed you are, what you know, nothing. None of that matters. It's just effect has the same cause every time. It's fantastic, isn't it? And if you think about, knowing this principle has so much potential to actually change human life on this planet. Because if you assume that everything with the same effect has the same cause, you can then start making experiments to actually prove that assumption. But the reality is, most people on Earth don't believe in that. They believe everything is unpredictable, right? And as a result of that, nobody has ever thought to actually measure a whole series of things that are the same for people, particularly when it comes to emotion. They've not thought to actually do that. Right? But it is predictable and it is going to be the same for each situation. So I reckon that's awesome, don't you? Yeah. Why would you not think it's awesome, right? Now let's just go back to our... Wrong way. No, let's skip over and go to the conclusion, but then I'll come back to the Fibonacci thing because I just want to show you some things with that. So the permanence principles ensure that all laws are unchangeable, consistent, permanent, self-enforcing, and that creations can rely on it. Permanence principles ensure that creations of the same type function in the same manner so that function is certain. Right? So an ant can't do what a bee does. Right? And this is the beauty of God's law, is everything is predictable. So when you see a bee, you know what it's doing. Yep. The only creation that is not so predictable is any being with free will obviously is not as predictable. However, it's interesting that the more developed you become, the more you see the predictability in error. In other words, when a person is in a state of emotional error, they become more predictable. They are not driven by desire very much at all, and they're driven by will, which is all about their addictions and their motivations and so forth, and they become very predictable. Sometimes you can predict what they're going to do for centuries, actually. That's how predictable they become. Yeah. Okay, so we frequently do all of the things, you know, justify, minimize desires, attitudes, emotions, thoughts and actions that oppose these principles by suggesting that love varies itself under different circumstances. And guys, you do this all the time. You say, I'll tell that person the truth, but that person I love, and I don't know if I want to tell them the truth because they might get upset, and part of me loving them means that I'm trying to make them not upset, so I'll not tell them. That's complete misunderstanding of all of God's laws and principles, actually, that causes that. And you're not loving them. You're just preventing an emotion inside of yourself. You're actually being selfish in that place. Believing all law is a process of negotiation. Most of you have this problem. You believe that God's laws can be negotiated with. That you're going to be able to get away with it, just like you could get away with things with mum and dad. You know, you could sometimes say you're sorry when you're not, and you could sometimes just have a cry in front of them and then they think that everything's fine. Or, you know, you could sometimes just punish yourself and then they'd let you off the hook. None of that works with God. None of it works with God's laws. Right? God's not negotiable. There's laws that allow for repentance and forgiveness, but they are not negotiations. Okay? Believing I can manipulate the law. Many of you believe this, that you can get away with it. You know, you get caught doing something, you go, oh, let me off the hook. Can you let me off the hook? You know, like, that's you believing you can manipulate the law. You know? Somebody points out you've been dishonest. You go, oh, yeah, but I did it because this and that, and I did it for that reason, and I really had my, you know, I was really trying to look after your feelings there, and you should let me off the hook for that. And, you know, and we do. Because people negotiate law like it's a, you know, like eating anything in the course of a day is just a natural, seems to be a natural desire in most people, just to negotiate law and to manipulate the results of it. And, you know, on earth, that's why bribery works, right? And many of you engage in bribery even when you're here. Like you're bribing people by, you know, saying something you don't really feel about them. Oh, isn't that wonderful you did that? And inside you go, like inside you feel completely different. Inside you feel a bit challenged, or you feel like, oh, you wish you could have done that, or, you know, you feel jealous or whatever it is. And it's all just a big facade at the front of it, you know. That's you trying to manipulate law. It's a big problem on the planet. Feeling no one, if no one is watching, then anything goes. Big problem on this planet. It's a big problem too in the hells of the spirit world, actually. Most people who are in the hells of the spirit world believe that no one really cares or is watching, and so they can do anything they want. And I'm talking now particularly those people who are earthbound feel that. So many of you are influenced by spirits who believe that. Feeling I have a special case. I'm special. I'm superior, or I'm better, or I'm a woman, or I'm a man, so I should get away with it. or I'm a child, or I didn't know. Makes no difference. Believing that only actions can be governed. Big problem that many of you have is you think, as long as you don't do it, everything else is allowable. You can think it, feel it, but as long as you don't do it, everything's fine. Well, that's not how God thinks. As soon as you thought it, had a feeling about it, now the law is in operation already. And one of you have asked a question about how that's the case, and we'll talk about that in the Q&A. Believing that superiority absolves me of certain law. In other words, well, I'm better than you, so I should get away with more things than you do. Right? That kind of belief. And it could be just that you feel that you're better than somebody else in a certain way, specific way. Or for many of you ladies, for example, in the audience, you believe you're just better than men completely. And so you think you're better than a whole half of the population. Right? Now, historically, men believe that about women. So you have these cycles happen in the environment. Through humanity, where one group of people believe themselves to be superior, they suppress another group of people who now feel inferior. Eventually, that inferior group of people get angry. Once they get angry, they now want to feel superior. So they do a whole heap of things to get superior. And then they punish the people who were superior before them, and that makes them feel inferior. And the whole cycle keeps going on for millennia like that. It even goes on generation to generation, where a woman may feel herself to be superior. So when she has a son, she thinks her son is the best son. And so she treats him like he's the best son. So he grows up believing he's the best son. So now he thinks he's superior. What do you think he's going to do treating other women? He's going to treat women badly. He treats women badly. They all feel inferior. The very thing that the woman was trying to prevent, his mother was trying to prevent. And it just goes on and on, cycle after cycle, cycle after cycle. All because we believe that under certain circumstances, I am superior and therefore I am absolved of what you should be asked to do. And in fact, I see this happening frequently where you believe other people should treat you a certain way, but you don't treat them in the same way. You don't. Yeah. You think other people should respect you, but frequently you don't respect others. So this is a lack of ethics. Permanence enforces ethics. Huh? Believing that circumstances dictate whether to obey the law. This is a big problem, isn't it, for us as well? Oh, but I had extenuating circumstances. Like, so I should be able to get away with it. Whether those extenuating circumstances are, oh, I'm sick, or I'm, you know, I'm a woman or a man, or I'm a child, or I wasn't taught that, or whatever reasons we come up with. Quite often it's like, oh, but I didn't know, so I should get away with it. Doesn't work like that with God. Ignorance isn't bliss with God. Believing that financial considerations allow for disobedience. In other words, if I give you some cash, can you just let it go? How often does that happen on the planet? I see many of you giving large amounts of cash to the most unloving people just to appease them, while at the same time giving hardly any cash to anybody who's more loving than you are. And the person who's more loving than you are would probably use that cash more wisely than the person who's unloving. But you give the unloving person the cash, the means, you give them the means to be more unloving. That's an example of believing that financial considerations allow for disobedience to permanence principles. Believing freedom means being able to ignore or break law. This is a big problem on the planet as well. If I'm truly free, I should be able to do anything. Right? Now, the reality is God has given you free will and you are allowed to do anything, but believing that if you break a law, there shouldn't be a penalty is a huge problem. It's a huge problem. We need to see that freedom has responsibilities associated with it. And some of those responsibilities, when it comes to being loving, that's the responsibility. Freedom requires love to be truly free. Resisting growing faith based upon previous experience. That's an example. So in other words, where you go, oh, but my mum treated me badly, and so now I believe that every woman on the planet is going to treat me badly, right? And so I'm justified getting angry with any woman on the planet as a result of that emotional behaviour that I have. Instead of having growing some faith that actually it's just your mum who treated you badly, it doesn't mean every woman's going to treat you badly. Right? But we try to apply the injury from humankind expression of law, which usually came from our parents and caregivers, and then we try to apply that same injury to God. So we basically say, oh, I can't trust God. I can't allow myself to believe in a God and those kind of things. And then we take a whole series of actions that are unloving as a result of those beliefs, thinking that we're going to be able to get away with them because we just didn't trust God or believe in God anyway. And when you find out later on there is a God, you might say to that God, you should let me get away with it because I didn't trust you before, right? You should just let me get away with that. And God's going to go, whether you know about me or not, the law's been broken. You're not going to get away with it. You're just not. That's how it's going to work. Suggesting that love varies itself under certain circumstances. And, you know, you can see that one pretty easily too, can't you? Suggesting there is no such thing as absolute truth. Oh, but that's, I see you doing this even now, you know, like myself or Mary comes up and shares with you, look, you've done something unloving there. Oh, no, I haven't, you know. No, it was you guys, you know, you didn't do this and you didn't do that, right? Suggesting there is no such thing as, no, there is a truth to what happened, and just because you have a set opinion about what happened, it doesn't mean that your opinion is actually right. What is the truth of what actually happened? How would God see the event that happened? Now, God sees it looking at the motivations of the individual as well as their actions, right? And when we try to address something with people, we see it the same way, the motivations and the actions. So you can actually not take an action and we'll still want to address the motivation. But many of you say, but I didn't do it. And I'm going, well, it doesn't matter whether you did it or not from God's perspective. The feeling in you is that you want to. And that's why I said in the first century, any man looking at a woman so as to want to commit adultery with her has already done so in his heart. And he's going to be judged on that. Right? Whether he thinks he took the action or not. And there is such a thing as absolute truth, and God measures it. All of the permanence present principles measure it. Okay, so they are the primary things that we want to discuss about the principle. Let's look at this Fibonacci thing, just because it's just interesting. And it might just help you see how God works with regard to mathematics a bit as well. Yeah. So the number scheme is the Fibonacci number scheme. Basically, it was discovered by an Italian man, but it's probably not discovered by him. He just probably heard it from some person in India who had some mathematical experience, and it probably wasn't discovered by him because he probably heard it from some place in Assyria that had a, you know what I mean, and it goes back for centuries, so it's not like, but it's called the Fibonacci series of numbers because the Italian man, I think it's in the 15th or 16th century, basically wrote it down and started describing it mathematically. Does that make sense? The number series is basically starts, so you start, you just add the previous two numbers together. So the next one will be one. One and one is, oh, you know that. sorry. Three. Next one is five, eight, 13, 21, 34. 55, 89, and of course it goes on forever. Huh? That's the Fibonacci series of numbers. It's a very interesting series of numbers because at the end of it, the higher you go in the number, if you get the highest number and divide it by the next highest number, the previous number, say 89 divided by 55, you get 1.618 with a lot of decimal places afterwards, but that's around about for the three digits. You get that. So what? It's also interesting that if you get the lowest number in a series and divide it by the next highest number, you get 0.618. You see, that's very unusual for an irrational number. But anyway, so there you go. But so what? Right. Well, it's very interesting because these numbers appear everywhere in nature. Everywhere in nature. Now, if you're an artist, you probably already know that. Right? Because there is a thing called the golden ratio, or the golden rule in art, which determines how you should properly proportion your drawings, even right down to properly proportioning people when you draw people in your drawings, right? So those of you who are artists would know that. So the reason why is because if you look at the human body, so I'll draw a very poor example of the human body. Let's use my body. My body's a bit out, so because I've got a bit of development to do yet. But the height of the person, let's assume that's 1.618. Right? So my height is, I think I'm 177 or 178 centimetres, right? So my height's 178 centimetres. And if we're in proportion, then if I multiply that by 0.618, I will actually get the height from the floor to my belly button. Right? But I'll also get, if I measure my arm, right, from my shoulder joint to the tip of my fingers, assuming that's the length of my arm, 0.618 of that happens to be my elbow. Right? The same applies if I measure from my hip joint to my floor, 0.618 of that is going to be my knee. The same goes with my hands, and the same goes with my face and where my nose and my forehead appears. They're all in the same proportions. Right? Now, it's been well known for many centuries that that's the case. Right? And so many artists have... And when you look at a drawing that's been done properly, like that you feel more sort of like it's more realistic, it always has those proportions. Any drawing that's out of harmony with those realisms feel like the person's disproportionate and there's something wrong with it. And in fact, it's interesting because much art that is now honoured as good art has disproportion in it, mostly because we're now attracted to disproportion more than we are to proportion due to emotional injuries. Nevertheless, these proportions exist. So this is a human body, just an example. Let's go to another example, a pine cone. In a pine cone, you'll find that if you draw a pine cone, so let's say this is a pine cone, you've got rungs that go around that way and runs that go around that way. Does that make sense? And if you count the runs that go around in one direction, you'll find that it's 8. And if you count the runs that go around in another direction, you'll find that it's 13. And there's a reason for that. The rotational angle for this number turns out to be about 137 and a half degrees, and that is the best way to utilize and capture light for a multi-leaved, anything that's multiple leaved. So you will find that certain things have a 3-to-5 ratio, certain things have a 2-to-3 ratio, certain things have a 1-to-2 ratio, certain things have an 8-to-13 ratio, for example, a pine cone, certain things have a 13-21 ratio, like a pineapple is a 13-21 ratio. Does that make sense? Yeah. If you look at the head of a sunflower, you'll find that it has multiple curvatures, and they all go up higher than 55, 55, 89, or 89 and the next number, and so forth in the series. Again, the same reason being that they capture the most light and therefore the most, they're the most efficient. If you look at a shell, like a nautilus shell, some nautilus shells and so forth, you'll see a curvature that goes like this. Is that snail shells and so forth? Well, the reason why that is if you get a number and you make a box and you say that's 1 and that's 1.618, and you divide that into a square, you end up with another box that's 1 and that's 1.618 in ratio to that number, and so forth. And if you keep doing that, and then you draw the intersections of that, you get the curvature. Does that make sense? It's the most efficient way to use energy to create to gather resources to use energy to create, for instance, a shell, a plant, and obviously our body as well. Now, it's all through nature, right? It's also in galaxies, spiral galaxies in particular. The way the energy is distributed is exactly the same way. And it's also right down into like minute detail into subatomic particles, but they have now found that there's some postulations that there's certain subatomic particles that have this ratio in them as well. And it wouldn't surprise me. So why have we included that in permanence? Well, there's a number of things it does for us, actually. It means that we can have a lot of different fields of inquiry and end up finding out the same thing. So, for example, you can be an artist and end up finding out about it. You could be a botanist and end up finding out about it. You could be someone who does cosmology and end up finding out about it. So you end up finding out about this one thing through lots and lots of different fields of endeavours, because this is a permanent part of natural structure. It's not the only natural structures, of course, but it is one that appears many, many times in nature. Does that make sense? Now, it's interesting you never really taught that at school, right? But why is that? You know what I think it is? Because it would make you start wondering how that could have occurred. Now, evolutionists would try to tell you that that occurred because spontaneously through some chance. I suggest to you that creating a number system and an irrational fraction system that is based on chance is, yeah, totally crazy, actually. It's a totally crazy suggestion. The chance of it happening just for that one system and then applying it to all these different things that are all so-called evolved in different ways, even though they suggest came from one source, is pretty crazy, actually, as an idea or concept. It indicates a huge amount of design. And if you just throw things up in the air and let them fall on the ground, I'm pretty sure they're not going to end up like that, you know, with design. They'll end up as random, in random orders. Right? Now, you know how they're starting to look at fractals and stuff like that now, and other systems that they've started to discover? These mathematical systems are all present in nature, from very simple ones like this one, right the way to very complex ones, right, that they're only just starting to even discover the mathematical formula for. Now, if we as intelligent beings have taken many thousands of years to discover a mathematical formula that now appears in nature, doesn't that tell you that whoever affected nature must have some intelligence? Of course it does. Right? But we ignore that, thinking that we want to believe that it all came about by chance. And we have a lot of emotional reasons why we want to believe that. Yeah. Many of which are religious, actually. And a kickback against religion. Now, I can understand people having a kickback against religion. The reality is that most religions, or pretty much all religions that I see, are basically just a whole heap of somebody's ideas all put together in writing, and a lot of the ideas seem to come out of, like, I don't know. If you were polite, you could say it might come out of their backside, but, you know, but they seem to have come for no reason. Do you know what I mean? It's just something that they wanted to dream up and imagine. Now, of course, that's not how God is. And so people say to me, oh, but you're talking about God, so are you religious? And I go, no. What do you mean? I'm not religious. Like, God's a scientific fact. To me, talking about God's a science, not a religion. Right? Religion is just a whole conundrum of ideas that in the end somebody imagined into being. That's all it is. And that's not what I'm talking about when I talk about God. So people keep accusing myself and Mary of starting a new religion. What's this new religion thing? There's no such thing as a new religion here, because God's truth is the truth of the universe. It's scientific fact. It's not a religion. So stop getting hung up on the religion thing and start seeing God's existence as a scientific fact, the mathematics involved behind it, scientific fact, all of the laws involved behind it, all scientific facts. So, I can't see how it's a religion. It's not something that I dreamed up. If you want to make something that I dreamed up, I would have come up with something probably completely different. And I would have been wrong. Right? Once you see what God has done, you definitely don't want to create a religion, because there's all this scientific fact that is the fact of the universe. Why would you want to put it in some kind of religious format? You wouldn't. It is just the factual part of the universe we live in. Okay, and I'll just check my size. I seem to have chewed up all of our time. And I haven't even done the comparison yet. That's the problem. I need to do the comparison, so I'm going to take a bit extra time, sorry, baby, in this presentation. So let's have a look at the comparison. God never varies the love's operation under any circumstances, and God's laws cannot be negotiated with and are always enforced consistently, right? The human concept of that is, humans suggest that love varies itself under every circumstance almost, and that humans believe all law is a process of negotiation. Big contrast, right? Almost completely opposite. God's concept, God's laws cannot be manipulated or appealed to. God's laws are self-enforcing and always observe the attitude, feelings, and actions. Human concept, humans believe they can manipulate the law enforcer. Humans feel if no one is watching, then no laws are enforced. Completely different. God's laws always operate and effects are guaranteed in all circumstances. God's laws operate upon the attitude and feeling and action of the individual. Human concept, humans feel they are a special case. Humans believe that only actions should be governed. You guys have an inside feeling that I feel from most of you, that you shouldn't be approached regarding your attitude, you should only be approached regarding your action. Right? God doesn't believe that. God wants to cure your motivation for your action, which actually is driven by your feelings inside of you. That's what he wants to cure. So his laws are surrounding that action, that emotion that drives the action. Right? Very, very different. God's laws operate without partiality, absolve no one. God's laws require obedience in all circumstances. Human concept, obviously. We believe that superiority absolves us of certain law and that circumstances dictate whether we should obey or not. It's interesting, when I was a kid, I used to play with other kids, of course, and, you know, if there was a sign on there saying trespass is prosecuted, what do you think the kids would do? Jump the fence, off they go. And I wouldn't, and they'd laugh at me and make fun of me and ridicule me or whatever, and I just wouldn't go. And that was because inside of me I had this feeling that, no, this is a request of that owner. I honour that person's desire to control whatever, you know, he's decided to buy. I also honour the fact that he's making a law and he has the right to make a law governing his own property. And so it's not right for me to enter that property. But the average person doesn't believe that, of course. God's laws do not consider financial circumstances. You think God's up there saying, right, pay me a bit and you'll get through. You know, it's like the whole concept, the Catholic concept of, you know, you're in purgatory and you got to pay a bit to get out. And you know, that's not going to apply, right? Definitely not going to apply. God's laws cannot be ignored, and freedom for all requires living in harmony with the law. This is what we need to understand. Humans believe that freedom means being able to ignore the law, but the trouble is, when you ignore a law, you're harming the freedom of someone else. So that's not freedom anymore. One person's feeling superior and says that I'm allowed to be free, but you're not, basically. That's what it's saying. And humans believe that financial consideration allows for disobedience. So pay a bit of money and we're in the business. So these are problems, right, that we face with regard to the concepts regarding permanence. And we can see with permanence, you can see just from this discussion that we had about the Fibonacci numbers, that permanence indicates that obviously there is a lot of mathematical certainty, right? And the reality is, as I've said to you already, the way God communicates is via mathematical certainty. That's how God communicates truth. So we need to start getting used to mathematics and start seeing and observing it and wanting to know about it if we really want to understand law. Okay, so what we're going to do now, myself and Lena, we'll just have a short changeover, which should take us about a minute, and then we'll handle some of your questions about the subject. All right, so this now is about Permanence Principles Q&A. We're going to start by just looking at a brief summary of the principles, which are basically related. Remember that it's those particular things that we're looking at: unchangeable, consistent, permanent, self-enforcing, structured, verifiable, mathematical, measurable, quantifiable, observable, safe and predictable. So these are the things we're trying to look at here in regard to this principle. So we get started on the questions. So David, what was your question?
In the development principles, it says laws and principles grow, evolve and change. But in permanence principles, it says laws are unchangeable. I have some confusion about this. Can you please clarify?
Yes. Now, firstly, development principles did not say that the principles evolve, grow and change. And they didn't say that the laws evolve, grow and change either. What they said was the principles and laws create other things that are allowed to grow, evolve and change. So it's the creation that is allowed to grow, evolve and change, and there's laws that are created to ensure that there's permanent laws, actually, that are created to allow the evolvement and change.
So the effect of the principles and laws is evolution, change.
Correct. Correct.
Makes heaps more sense.
Makes sense, right? Yep. So the reality is the permanence principles are applied to development principles. In other words, every development principle and every life principle is permanent. Mm. But they allow for the creation to change, and they also allow for the creation to create new laws which are then permanent. Once those laws are created, then they are also permanent. Does that make sense? But the law itself allows for this growth and development to occur, which therefore forces change upon creation.
Yeah, makes heaps more sense. Thank you.
Yeah, so it's important to get the distinction, and so here we can see now that the laws, well, let's start with the principles. The principles are permanent. Because the permanent principle exists in every principle, actually. So the principles are permanent. Therefore, they create laws that, once the law is created, is permanent. They even create the potential for new laws, and once the new laws are created, they are also permanent. Right? And they also then allow creation to grow and develop. That's a part of the permanence, allowing creation to actually grow and develop. Does that make sense?
Yeah, none that seems clearer now.
Yeah, yeah. Does anyone want to ask more about that? Felix, you want to just go straight behind?
In the higher realms of the spirit world, if a human creates, that's all. When a human creates, it's also can be permanent. And is that always the case?
Yep. Well, if it's there are laws that also dictate when something will be destroyed, and how that thing will become get destroyed. So, but those laws are also permanent. But it doesn't mean the creations are permanent, because they will change. Does that make sense? So don't mix the creation, which is the effect of, with the law, which is the cause of. We want to make sure that we understand that the law governs the creation. The creation is constantly evolving and changing, right? But the law allows that to occur. And it's the permanent laws that allow that to occur.
So do you mean that if a human creates something that's in harmony with love and God's love and truth,
yes,
then it is always permanent?
Yes, until that human decides to
change it.
Okay. Change it or destroy it, yes. Does that make sense?
Yep.
And they may create something that is in harmony with love and truth and then down the track decide to destroy it. It doesn't happen very frequently, but they may decide to do that just because that's their feeling. They want to do that. And when it gets destroyed, the laws that govern the destruction of something also come into play, and those particular elements that were used in that creation now will get used in other creations. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Okay. So, if Christine, if you want to go back to your posse and find your question.
How does God's laws operate on our attitude, feeling and action?
Yes, I think that's a very good question, hey? Because I've talked to you about this frequently, right, how God's laws do this, but most of you have not considered how that might happen. It's very, very simple, actually, but probably not something you've given much consideration to or thought of. Man, it's hard to get this stuff off once it's on, isn't it, sometimes? I think I'll stick with the purple. It's the trouble with using that alcohol, is it eventually mixes with the thing. Okay, here's our soul. Remember, our soul is combined. It's just the illusion that it's separate. So here's our soul. What is an emotion?
Energy.
It's energy in motion. What's a desire? It's a specific type of emotion, so therefore it's a focused energy in motion. Does that make sense? It's the same kind of thing, isn't it? Okay, so we established that emotions are flowing through us as energy, right? So how does the law measure energy? So that's really all it has to do, isn't it? The law has to measure energy and its flow in order to determine what is happening inside of us. That's all it's got to do. So what God's laws do is they look at this energy in motion and the type of energy that is in motion, and they work upon, the law governs what is going to happen with that particular type of energy in motion. That's all it does. Does that make sense?
Yes. Yep.
And that's how it determines what you're thinking of and feeling. Now, a thought is also an energy process in the soul. It begins in the soul generally, but even a thought passing through your brain has all these synapses all connecting, and there's chemical transmissions that are going on to connect as well. So these connections are transmitted to the physical brain, but the reality is it's the spirit body's brain that's having the thoughts, because you'll find that your thoughts don't disappear when your body disappeared, right? When your body disappears, your spirit body is still there, and it still has the same thoughts. So that should tell you that the thoughts are coming from the spirit body. And if your spirit body disappears, you still have the same thoughts, So that tells you that even the spirit body's thoughts have to come from the soul. So a thought is actually something that flows through the soul and as an energy system, as an energy connection, and God's laws measure energy. So now God's laws are going to be able to measure what kind of thought you had and what kind of feeling you had and measure whether that thought or feeling is out of harmony with the law and therefore requiring a correction or in harmony with the law and requiring a reward. Does that make sense? Yeah. It's very important to understand that if you think about it, because everything I've been teaching you about your feelings, you can see straight away that if all of God's laws operate upon energy like that, then that means that every single feeling and every single thought you have, that's what God's laws are operating on, not on just your actions. Now, an action is a thought or a feeling that has been had enough motivation in you to be completed in an action, but God's laws began judging it, if you could say it from that perspective, from the time of the conception of the thought or the feeling. The desire gave birth, the desire was born, and as soon as that desire was born, God's laws are measuring it. Does that make sense to you? Yeah. Does that make sense to you, Christine?
Yes.
Yeah. So you can see that the fact that God's laws measure emotion or energy in motion means that we now need to be concerned about not just what we do, but what we feel and what we think is what we need to be more concerned about. Right? That's what we need to be concerned about.
Does that somehow have a mathematical equation?
Yeah, what did we say about our principles? Every law has a mathematical equation, yes. So actually every type of energy that could possibly flow through your soul has and can be described by a mathematical equation. Yeah. Pretty good system, yeah? Pretty exact, eh? Can you see how God can make exact laws? He just describes the emotional flow as an equation, and anything that's related to that equation gets this particular penalty if it's disobeyed or this particular reward if it's obeyed. So now we have a complete relationship between the law and what you choose, how your will is exercised. All described mathematically, but also emotionally. Now, it's a lot easier for me to explain to you the emotion being a problem than it is for me to write a great big long equation of a mathematical equation and say, that emotion is your problem. You know, it's better if I say, that equation is anger and that's your problem, or something like that, isn't it? So you can see that there's a simple way to present God's truth, a child can understand who has no mathematical experience, or a very, very complicated way you could present it, right? So which am I going to prefer? The simple way, of course. Yeah. And God's done it purposefully like that so that you can come at the situation of whatever is going on inside of you emotionally. God's done it like that so that you can easily see what is happening rather than having to have a whole heap of mathematical knowledge before you can understand what is happening. Right. But don't think that it's exact. Don't think that it's not exact, sorry. It is very exact. Every single feeling that passes through you, every single thought that passes through you can be measured and quantified and therefore can be controlled by law. And in fact, God has not created anything in the entire universe that cannot be governed by law. Everything that God has ever created is governed by law. Okay, we need to move on. So let's look at, it was Natalie next, wasn't it? Is that right? Yep. Here we go.
Can I just ask a question about that question?
You can.
Okay. So
there's a lot of ums and ahs now.
Sorry. I had a thought the other day. I went to speak to my son and I then hurt myself. And what I realised in the moment when I went back to the thought was...
Now, this is just a selfish question, so you need to move on.
When you say effect of the same kind has the same cause, is this for everything?
Yes.
And if so, then how do we discover a specific cause when it's not always obvious? The example being...
No, God's made it so it is always obvious.
Okay. So how do doctors reassess cause from God's perspective, and can they do it without a belief in God?
Well, highly unlikely, isn't it, in the long run? You can certainly examine some. It's not like you can be a scientist and not believe in God, right? And there's plenty of scientists on the planet who've created many things. I'm sure many of the scientists who created your mobile phone happened to be people who didn't believe in God, right? But they did believe in the laws. So at the end, the scientific process really only requires that you believe in the law. It doesn't require that you believe in the lawmaker.
Okay.
However, if you want to look at things that you can't currently see with regard to the spirit, body and the soul, then obviously your belief in God is going to help you greatly to even want to examine those particular fields of endeavour than if you have no belief in God and no belief in an afterlife and therefore no belief that such things are possible. And if you don't believe something's possible, are you going to investigate it? Of course not. No. Right? So it's very, very important that you come to understand that at the end of the day, if you want to have a limited scope of or field of inquiry, then sure, don't have to believe in God. But it's going to be a very limited field of inquiry now. You've now limited yourself because you're not connecting to the actual creator of all these things. You don't understand the majority of the laws. You also can't understand how to measure a lot of things because you don't believe in them.
And so that kind of prevents then from absolute truth.
Of course.
Yeah.
So they, scientists do believe in absolute truth, but only as it pertains to the physical.
Yeah, right.
They don't believe in absolute truth generally when it pertains to the emotional or the spiritual. And what I'm suggesting is no. The fact that absolute truth exists in the physical also means that absolute truth exists in the emotional and the spiritual. Does that make sense? And each thing can be measured and quantified just like it can be measured and quantified in the physical.
But you have to have an opening at least to a concept of God.
Of course you do. Yeah. There's many spirits in the spirit world who would love scientists to believe in the spirit world, because then many of those scientists in the spirit world who've passed from Earth would be able to give scientists on Earth a lot more inspiration about what fields of endeavour they need to go down.
Yeah.
But they feel very frustrated at the moment because there's too many scientists on Earth that don't allow that kind of communication, therefore don't allow the influence.
Thanks.
Yep. So that's a good question in regard to the fact is every effect of the same kind has the same cause. Stop thinking that there's any exception because there are none. There's none. Right? Okay. Yeah. How much time have I got? Oh, I'm now at my time, aren't I? I'm just trying to keep 12:10 and it's 12:10. Okay, well, a lot of these now are going to probably have to wait for our sessions at home, because there's quite a lot of questions, as you can see, on the subject, but unfortunately, we're not going to get time to cover them. Sorry about that, guys. All right, so it's best for us now to... That's the end of the Q&A. It's best for us now to have a 10-minute break and to get started on the next session, otherwise we'll get behind in the day. So, thanks.